So I wanted to present on the memoirs of Marcia Tucker, but when I was preparing my talk, I couldn't figure out if what I found most influential was Marcia Tucker the person or Marcia Tucker the author of these memoirs. And this is kind of a common question to literature, like, is it the author or is it the character that captivates us? And so instead of solving this tension, I decided to reproduce it for everyone. So I'm going to read a very personal letter that I've written to Marcia Tucker out loud in front of all of you. Dear Marcia, it is 2016 and you are dead. You have been dead for 10 years now. I vaguely recall you teaching at my alma mater while I was there, but I was too young to be able to take your course or know who you were. Never mind, though, because you came into my life at exactly the right time. You won't know this, but in 2008 there was a brutal economic recession, and that's just about the time I graduated from that college you used to teach at. That summer I emailed anyone with a Hotmail account asking for work. I got a job with the socialite art curator, who some months later would call me on the train and scream at me for demanding that she pay some $200 in overdue wages. I ended up finding out that this woman bit someone on a transatlantic flight recently while wearing a tiara. And now whenever you Google her name, you get to read headlines like, "There was absolutely no biting," and "Stacey Engman accused of biting granola girl who had class envy over tiara." I'm still waiting for my $200. This was 2009 and you had been dead for 3 years. Then it was Christmas and my dad, who reads exactly zero books, did the very thoughtful thing of buying me all the books he could find related to art on the New York Times bestseller list. That's where we found your book. I don't know when I finished reading your book, but you died on October 17th, 2006. When I finished the book, I cried. Even writing this now, I feel those similar vapors. I knew then that you had died. I know it now. I don't know why I cried then, or why I want to cry now, and no other book has made me cry. I was so humbled moving to London in 2012. Everyone knew so much more than me. I was loud and clunky, and always just a little bit old-fashioned in my beliefs, which had seemed progressive back home. But I read your book and knew about your favorite artist, Tesshing Shea. I knew about his weird one-year performances, where he punched a time clock every hour on the hour, and lived tied to another artist by an 8-foot rope. It was a relief to know stuff and to know good stuff. It made me feel less visible, less on display as the stupid American with flashy teeth and grating positivity. I still live in London and I'm doing a PhD, both of which are really hard and for different reasons. I say I want to be a curator like you, but more and more I don't know what that means. I'm overwhelmed by the administration of curating, which is so great it seems to blot out the creativity of it. And lately I feel uninspired by curating. I'm unsure of my point of view. I'm scared of my job prospects. I think a lot about you in these moments, you and the choices you made. Marcia, how did you do it? You made a career out of shows almost universally panned by critics. You were dismissed by that rank misogynist Clement Greenberg at the opening of your show. Did you feel the way I often do? Silenced and shrunken in that moment of encounter, and then afterwards limitless rage for all the injustices you suffered, and hot shame that you weren't smart enough or quick enough to fight back in that moment when it was happening? Clement Greenberg was a dick. Back then, they said curators were supposed to draw primarily from art historical sources when researching artists, which you mostly did, but you also didn't. You said you learned more from what your artists were reading, whatever that was, more than anything else. You opened art up. You invited people in. I'm writing my PhD thesis on landscape art and reading all the Latin American authors I can find. I don't know why the two are related, but it feels like a compulsion I am unable to fight. In my mind, the connection between these two things is nebulous and foggy, but in my gut, it is clear and purposeful. I like to think you would be enthusiastic about this. You had so much integrity. You presciently tried to diversify your staff and exhibitions after you started the new museum. Maybe that's because you were a Jewish woman in the New York art world. Or maybe that was just you. When that Australian art critic Bob Hughes complained that every one-legged Chicana lesbian who demands a show gets one, you responded from your seat in the audience by saying, "Speaking as a one-legged Chicana lesbian," I like to think that you did that because that was just you. And then I wonder if I would have been so brave to publicly speak against a colleague on the basis of what I believed was right, to risk ridicule and criticism, alienation and isolation. It's hard to be clear on what you believe is right when the people telling you you're wrong are closer and closer to your heart. Maybe this was why you were blindsided when you brought in a consulting firm to do an audit of the workplace conditions at the new museum when it wasn't even 5 years old. Maybe this was why no one wanted to tell you that they were miserable, because they weren't clear on how they could believe in a person so much and at the same time be so let down by her. Perhaps it was so easy for you to be clear on what you believed was right because you followed your work. You loved art, you loved ideas, and you made the rest noise. You didn't ask for permission. You didn't take it either. You just made the kinds of things you wanted to make. You did the kind of work you wanted to do time and time again. It's nearly 2017, and I'm revisiting your book for the first time in a long time. I'm rereading passages now that I've carried with me, in my head, almost word for word since the first time I read them in 2009. I'm a month away from turning 30, and so much of what used to be important to me about your book back then has dropped away. New things are important to me now, like how you were 43 before you had your first and only child, and how that desire to be a mother didn't conflict or erode your aspirations to start a museum, to be an art curator, to be a writer, to be a lecturer, to perform comedy improv. Marcia, you make me feel like it's possible for one person to do things, and quite incredible things. You make me more confident about making mistakes, about failing, about not being recognized for my work, about being recognized for my work, but for the wrong reasons. You make me feel like being human isn't a thing to overcome as a curator, but precisely the thing that will make me as a curator. It's 2017. In 2017, I will be 30, and you will be dead for 11 years. And in 2017, I will think of you, and think of how I read you in 2009, and think of how I read you again in 2016. And I will try to take more risks and make more mistakes. And if I don't end up doing that, then that's okay too, because as a one-legged Chicana lesbian, all I have to do is ask for my place in the art world, and surely it will be given to me. All my love, Nicole.